here in our text this morning in Luke 15 is that what I will call daddy love is different from a mother's love. Daddies love you differently. You see what a mother does is a mother caresses you and a mother loves on you and a mother cares for you, but a father's responsibility is to prepare you for the future. A father's responsibility is he has all this stress on him because he has got to, you know, and some of the testimonies, and thanks for everyone who shared this morning. You saw that, oh Jesus, 16 children. And I come from California, man. We had like 2.5 kids. That was it. You know, y'all was raising football teams. And now, oh my God. But can you see the responsibility? I mean, they talk about the father, and a lot of times the fathers were the only one working, and so you have all the responsibility to raise you. So, you know, father's like, I ain't got time to cuddle you. You got to get up and do some work up in here. You know, so the father love is so very different than a mother's love. And we really need to understand that, and for young fathers and for fathers to be, you need to understand that. Because, and I'll never forget this, when the first lady was pregnant, this guy came to me, pulled me inside and said, look, man, this is what you need to know. There's going to be times in your house, once you have children, that you're going to be the most hated person in the house. Because you've got to do what you've got to do, and everybody is not going to like it. Because we have been taught, we have been shown that we do things a little bit different. We got to take care of this thing. Yeah. You know, I'm sorry, I can't cover you all the time. But daddy love. So the title of the sermon this morning is going to be called Daddy Issues, Daddy Love. Daddy Issues, Daddy Love. And so as we look at this parable that Jesus taught, it's so very interesting the way it was written, because it just makes it seem like it just flowed so very easily, but it was not always that way. In verse 11, we learn right away that there is a father who has two sons. And one of the sons, the younger sons, depending on the translation, he said, I want my part of the estate, or basically what he was saying was, I want my inheritance. And so it seems so nonchalant, seems so easy. I want my inheritance. Oh, but in the Jewish culture, it was much worse than that. And because sometimes a father would voluntarily, when he was ready to retire, he would give his inheritance to his sons. And we talked about that. I also wanted to thank the women for their revival. Amen. For those who came, y'all not have a blessed time in the name of Jesus. For Pastor Brooks and for Elder Barnes, bless our socks off. And Pastor Barnes talked a lot about inheritance. But the one thing that you know is that in order to get an inheritance, somebody has to die. And so as a young man, when you came to your father and said, I want my inheritance, basically what you were saying is, Daddy, I wish you were dead. So I care more about your money than I care about my relationship with you. I want to have this. And so for the Jewish culture, to ask for your inheritance was a tremendous insult. And in fact, it didn't happen a lot, because when it did happen, here's what the father could do. They said, look, what the father would do is they would slap the son upside the face, kick him out of the house with no money, and then call a meeting of the community, because the communities were always small and everybody was related, so they knew everything that was going on. And he would say, this man is no longer my son, and he is not welcome in my house or in my community. That's how serious, this thing was really, really serious. It was a sign of the ultimate disrespect that while your father was alive, that you asked for your inheritance. So that is the setup for what has happened here. And then it goes on to say that the father divided up the estate and gave it to the son. And it wasn't that easy either. Because there had to be some, because here's the thing. So Jesus was talking to, they said in verse 14, they let us know that there was a large crowd following Jesus. So there was a large crowd that was, in verse 15, it says he's talking to the tax collectors, he's talking to sinners and the Pharisees. So there's a lot of people here, and when he began to tell this story, the people listening to it would say, say what? You did what? Because if you are a man in the village and you gave your estate to your son, now you have set everybody else up. Now, his
son's coming to get his, and his son's coming to get his. And so this man, he would be looked, if he had any props in the community, he lost them all right there by giving. So it was not an easy thing for this man to do. It was not an easy thing for this man to divide it up. So how it worked is that if he was going to divide up the estate, because he had two sons, the oldest son always got 2/3, and the younger son got 1/3. So the Bible tells us that he divided everything up, and he gave it to his youngest son. And the youngest son said, quickly, real quickly, the son packed up and booked. Homeboy wanted to go on a time. He was one of those rebellious sons. You know, there's a few of us in here today. Couldn't wait to get out of the house. Man, I mean, we didn't ask for no money, because probably wasn't no money to be asked for, but we could not wait to get out of the house. I mean, we're like, 17, what's the age? 17, 18, whatever it is, we tried to get out of the house. So here's the other son, because you have to understand, in the Jewish culture, the father was responsible for the education, the discipline, and the religious training in the house. The father, he ruled with an iron hand. Well, Sister Bell, you said your father was a rough man. All them Jewish dudes were rough men. I mean, they ruled with an iron hand, an iron fist. You had to do this, you had to do that. And so the younger son, like, I have had enough. Get me out of here. I got to go. I got to get out of here. So here's the thing that I want you to understand. I'm going to make point number one, is that be careful what you ask for. Be careful, watch this, be careful what you ask the Father for, because you might just get what you ask for. So here's the young son, he asked the Father, give me the money, and he gave him the money, he packed up, and the Bible says that he went to a foreign land. What that means is that he went to a land where the Jews were not in control, because he had had so much of all this Jewish overseeing, he had so much of this heavy-handed Jewish stuff, so he's going somewhere where there were no Jews. But please understand, if you know where the promised land is, you know that the Jews got there by fighting and defeating everybody along the way. So there's hardly anywhere this kid could go where they did not hate the Jews. Nobody liked the Jews, except for a Jew with money. So here he is, he's got money, and the Bible tells us he's spending on the wildlife. Party over here. You knew what to do. What's up? He took the money and had a party. We find out in verse 30 that he not only spent it having a party, but he spent it on prostitutes. Oh, he was having a fucking good time. But the Bible later on tells us it didn't take long before he ran out of cash. Huh? He ran all out of the money, and here he is. He's in a foreign land. Now, all the friends he had, oh, help me, G, come on now. When you got money, you got friends, but you don't have no money. Oh. Hey, friends go away when you don't have no money. You know what kind of friends. I might ask for a raise of hands. But you might be one of them friends. I ain't going there. Not today. And so he's out of money. He doesn't have any cash. And the Bible says that there was a famine in the land. Oh, no. Anytime you read in the Bible that famine's in the land, all you know is there's trouble. Famine represents trouble, man. A famine means that now there's no food, there's nothing. You can see, in reality, most of the time they talked about a famine, they talked about food, but in reality, what a famine is a loss of anything that is necessary for you to live. So we've all been through a famine. Whether you lost your job, whether you lost your check, whether you lost the house, whatever you lost, when you lost something that was a necessity. Amen? Actually, I don't know how many people here have really been hungry. See, most of the time we're not hungry. Because I have my kids are like, Daddy, I'm hungry, can you give me some money to eat? I said, there's food in the refrigerator. I don't want to eat that. You ain't hungry. Huh? You ain't hungry. You're inconvenienced. You're hungry, you're going to buy something. There's plenty of food over here to eat. But the Bible tells us that here is the young son, and the young son, he's all out of money, and he has to hire himself out, the Bible says. And he hires himself out to go to a pig farm. Now, please understand, you know, we just sort of gloss over that in the text, but for a Jew, pigs were unclean. Jews would not even touch pigs. So for a Jewish boy to have to feed pigs was the lowest of the low. Let me make it plain for all of us here. For us, it would be like a young black man having to serve and clean at the Ku Klux Klan vehicle. This is the worst of the worst, the bottom of the barrel. And he said he was so hungry, he wanted to eat the pig's food. This is a Jewish man. So when he said, they're starving me to death, nobody is giving me anything, so can you, I want you to look. So now he leaves this house. You know he came from a house of wealth because his father was being able to divide up the property and still have money to run his house. And we find out later that his father had servants, his father had food, his father had enough money to start a quick party. So he came from money, all right? But now he's broke, hasn't eaten in a long time, nobody's given him anything, he hasn't bathed, he hasn't brushed his teeth, his clothes are dirty, he's dealing with pigs, he don't smell good, y'all, this is a stinking man. This is the bottom of the barrel. So understand this. Sometimes God will allow us to hit rock bottom. See, so don't be surprised. You know, so I asked the Lord, and see, the Lord believes in free will. And so did this father, because the father in our parable here is the equivalent of God, and the son is his children. And then the Lord says, look, I'm going to give you free will. If that's what you want to do, you go ahead and do it. But you got to watch what you ask for. You have to watch the consequences, because undoubtedly the father knows. You see, come on, Holy Spirit. Y'all got to pray. Come on, let me finish real quick. Get out of here before 1 o'clock. That's true. You got to hear five love makes it. So what we have to understand is that here is this young man, and now he is filthy, dirty, living with pigs. He has hit the very, very bottom of the barrel. Things are as bad as they have ever been for him. And the Bible says in verse 17, he came to his senses. Hallelujah. Sometimes, I don't know how many of y'all have been there, but sometimes it takes hitting the bottom of the barrel before you come to your senses. Because you see, here's the thing. Because the father was the one who raised the son up, he undoubtedly knew Proverbs 22:6, which tells us, raise a child up in the way that they should go. But here's the key that we tend to ignore. It says, and when they are older, they will not forget. So I'm figuring like this here. Most of the time, from 18 until you get about 28 or so, that's the year when you just act buck wild, crazy as you can be. Amen. You still think you can outrun God. Amen. Do all this stuff. And then once you get older, after the world done bopped you upside your head, after the world done put you on the train tracks, ran over you, put the train in reverse and ran over you again. Now somebody been there. Y'all can laugh if you want to. Yeah, you can pretend that you never happened. But you've been there. You hit the bottom of the barrel, and it is only then. Ooh, help me, Jesus. See, sometimes we got to go through so we will come to our senses. Amen? It takes all of that for us to come to our senses. And so the man, so here's the kid, he's weak. He done lost a whole bunch of weight because he hasn't been eating. He looks crazy because he hasn't been bathing. He smells crazy because he's been with the pigs. His clothes are dirty because no one's doing anything for him. And he comes to his senses. And he said, look at here. I'm hungry. I can't get nothing to eat, but there is not a servant in my father's house that is hungry like this. So I understand now that I have sinned against my father and the community. So now he understands. He's like, okay, it's time for me to repent. And he says, what I'm going to do, he had a plan. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go back home. I'm going to tell my father, I am not worthy to be your son. Forgive me for what I've done. I'm not worthy to be your son. Let me be one of your servants. Because at least they get something to eat. And he said that he got up. And he made his way home. We find out later that however far it was, he ain't even had no shoes. He walking back. This dude looking bad. He's looking bad. He's emaciated. He's dehydrated. He's all that weighted. He's bad. He's looking bad. And he's coming home. And the Bible says that the father saw him from a long ways off. Well, I'm getting ready to round this thing up. You see, it said that, so in order for the father to see him, that means the your father hasn't been looking. The Father's been waiting for his son. I need for somebody to understand in the name of Jesus that even when we go off, even when we go the wrong way, even when we do the what we're not supposed to do, turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, the Father's looking for you. Now watch this, watch this. The son said, he did not say, I need to go back home. He said, I need to go back to my father. I need to go back to the what? I need to go back to the source. And he said he saw him for a long ways off. Now he didn't look like he used to look. He didn't walk like he used to walk. He certainly didn't smell like he used to smell. But somehow, a daddy knows what his son looks like when he's walking. And he said he saw him for a long ways off. And then he had compassion for his son. And then the Bible tells us that he ran. I need for you to understand that the men of that century, the older men, they did not run. They did not run at all. This was probably the first time this man had run in years and years and years and years. I need for somebody to understand this morning. Don't look at me like you've never been there. Somebody needs to understand this morning that God will run for you. God has been waiting for you. God has been making a way out of no way for you. He's been waiting for you to come to your senses. Waiting for you to get it right again. Waiting for you to understand he don't care what you did. He don't care where you were. He don't care how low you were. He don't care what you smell like. He don't care what you look like. In the name of Jesus, we need to understand that we serve a God who loves us so much that he did the daddy love. He did the tough love because he had to let you go. He did the tough love because you had to learn something on your own. But you need to understand this, and even today, the daddies love you a different way. Oh, but your daddy loves you. He loves you so much that he looks a far way off. He's always looking for you. He's always waiting for you. He's always saying, I'm waiting for you to come on back to daddy, because daddy loves you and has a great plan for your life. He's running for you in the name of Jesus. Not with this God. We serve a God who will forgive us. Oh, help me, Jesus. Our God will forgive us before we will forgive ourselves. Amen? Amen. Some, you know, we deal with this stuff and we do stuff and it's like, oh, you feel so bad and your God will never forgive you. No, I need for you to understand. God's been looking for you. God's been waiting for you to come to your senses. Come to understand. You see, hallelujah, he knew that the foundation had been set. That's why it's so important for your kids to go to Sunday school. That's why it's so important that you read scriptures to the kid, because at some point in their life, they're going to need to come to their senses. They're going to need a scripture that says that the Lord is my strength and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? They're going to need to know something about a God when they reach rock bottom and know this God still loves them. And he ran. Oh man, you know, these dudes, it always got me that in the desert, they wore like 4 or 5 layers of clothes. So they had a long robe, and they had underclothes, they had all this stuff. And in order to run, they had to wrap all this stuff up and get all this stuff up. Oh my goodness, but it didn't matter to the father, because he wanted to get to his son. It didn't matter to the father, because he said, I love you so much, I'm going to risk pulling this hamstring. Help me, Jesus. Come on now, somebody know. I'm going to risk tearing my Achilles tendon, but I'm going to get to you, boy, because I love you so much, and I'm just glad that you're coming home. It don't make no difference about me. I love you. I need you to know God loves us all. I need to know if you slip and you fall. I need to know if you slip. What was the song? Slipping in the darkness. Help me, Joe. I ain't going in today. But when you slip in the darkness, I want you to know God is going to always give you enough strength to get out. I need for you to know that God's going to give you a light. God's going to give you somebody or something that's going to give you enough strength. Because God is saying, I see. He ran and he put his arms around him and he kissed him. In the name of Jesus. Now notice, all of this happened before the son could say anything. Huh? The son had a plan of repentance. The son had, I'm not. And then later on, he said, you know, and so kissing them was a sign that whatever it is, son, you are forgiven. whatever you've done, wherever you've been, I know you spent all your money. You come back and you look terrible. And boy, I'm holding my nose, but I'm bugging you anyway. All this stuff is happening. But he wants you to know, I don't care what it is. I love you. I've been waiting for you, son. Every day I've been looking for you to come back in the name of Jesus. I want somebody to know that God has been waiting for somebody. God has been looking for somebody. You see, because the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 13, and starting in verse 4, when it talks about love, it says that love does not hold on to what was wrong. It keeps no record of what is wrong. Oh, help me, Jesus. I'm talking to somebody. You see, we're the ones who keep a record of what's wrong. We're the one, when the person tries to come back, we're the ones snarling our nose all up at them. We're the ones looking at them and they don't smell right. But we need to do like the Father in this parable. And we need to love on somebody. We need to hug somebody. We need to kiss somebody and let them know that it's going to be all right because I love you just like God. So then he gives his speech. Father, I'm not worthy to be your son. Just make me one. And Father, I'm like, boy. He called the servant and said, man, get the best robe and put it on. Get a ring and put it on his finger. Put some sandals on them dirty feet. Because he who once was lost is now found. Go kill the fatted calf. We get ready to have a party up in here because my son who was lost has come back. I want everybody to know. I don't care how far away you've gone. I don't care what you've done. The Father in heaven is saying, I want you to come back. I'm waiting for you. I know you went through daddy love, daddy issues, but now here is daddy love. The Father loves you and he wants you back. In the name of Jesus. So this morning, I just want you to understand daddy love. And sometimes daddy love takes you through. Mama's gonna love you and caress you. Mama gonna pick you up. When you have babies and babies fall down, you rarely see a father running over to pick the baby up. Right? Daddy be there like, oh, you wanna get up, you gotta get up. And mama's be, oh, my God. That's the difference between mama love and daddy love. Daddy understands that when you fall down, later on, ain't nobody gonna be there to pick you up. And so understand, you know, these daddy issues because you know everything is a mother's love. Oh, a mother's love, and a mother's love is great. Couldn't make it without a mother's love. Couldn't make it without it. And I'm not downplaying a mother's love because a mother's love is so very special. But a father's love is special too. A father's love does something and a mother's love simply can't. Because a father is I'm trying to get you ready, son. I'm trying to get you ready for this world. I'm trying to get you ready, but nobody ain't gonna like you. Nobody's gonna caress you. Nobody's gonna kiss on you. I gotta get you ready. So I gotta be hard on you. I gotta be tough. But please don't misunderstand. Daddy loves you. Daddy loves you. Daddy issues, daddy love. Turn your neck and say, neighbor. Daddy loves you.
Daddy loves you.
Earthly daddy.